Hello.
What's happening, Patton? It's that bi-yearly time of the year where everybody actually goes and buys Criterions from Barnes & Noble. I swear it's the only time of the year where Barnes & Noble actually moves Criterions off the shelves. But it is. It's the 50% off Criterion sale at Barnes & Noble, a pretty celebrated event in the collector sphere of movies. And if you're anything like me, you go to these Criterion sales, spend way more money than you intended to for things that are just going to sit on your shelves and eventually watch 5 years later. You really let that FOMO and that thrill seeking,
that real adrenaline rush
kind of just take over your body as you run around and manically buy up Criterions from multiple Barnes and Nobles. So I've decided to set out a challenge for myself today when I go out to get these Criterions, and that is limit myself to only two films that are complete blind buys. Now, I will say there are some stipulations I can have to this challenge. I am only to pick up two Criterions, but I can substitute out one of those Criterion picks for an Arrow Video release, because typically Arrow Video also has sales coinciding with the Criterion sale, or I can sub out one Criterion movie for two Janus Contemporary movies, because Janus Contemporary is Criterion's like second line and they are cheaper than regular Criterion's. But I do kind of want to try to pick these movies out by knowing as little about them as I possibly can. So let's go see what we can find. Pluto.
Darn.
I know it's not Criterion, but I was hoping to get Pluto Volume 2, but they don't have it. Pluto's really good. Well, at least Volume 1 was. But they don't have Volume 2.
Poopy. Alright, let's go see what they got for Criterions.
They have a fire. That's my watch list. That says 30% off. I thought it was 50% off. Is the Janus Contemporary's not? This should be half off because they have the Eight Mountains too. This is gonna be hard. It's not a huge selection, not like it used to be. All That Breathed by Janus Contemporaries. I've already seen this, so I can't get it today, but it's really good. This is one that if I wasn't doing this challenge, I actually would take home with me. I hate the little like spider wraps because they just sit here and click the whole time. It's annoying. Arsenic and Old Lace. It's a cool title. I already know of Cure. I do really want to see it. But I do know about it already. So I'm trying to go a little bit more blind than that one. Ooh, The Celebration. I don't know much about this one. I know it's Thomas Vinterberg. I think it's how you say his name. And I know it's part of the Dogma 95 movement, but outside of that, I don't know much about it. So this could be a contender. So I've never heard of this. This is Bound by the Wachowskis of The Matrix. And what was the Juniper movie with Channing Tatum? I'm pretty much just any of them that I see that I don't recognize the name of, I'm just pulling to look at. Faye Day, I've never heard of this. I'm probably not even saying that right. That one sounds pretty cool. That one's so far one of the top contenders. This is a burial, not a resurrection. It's one of the best movies of 2021. Recommend that to anybody. Oh yeah,
we gotta look to see if they have any Arrow stuff, because Arrow can be a contender, and who knows what you'll find. But although I don't see any signs saying Arrow's on sale, so I'd have to look on their website first. So far, only Last House on the Left, but my rules are gonna apply. It's gotta be a blind buy, so the rules are still applying to even Arrow. Ooh, this is actually a solid recommendation. Sleep, pretty cool German film with, isn't Isabella Huppert is in this? No, Sandra Hüller. It's Kino. So apparently Kino, Cohen, Zeitgeist are all on sale too. So we might have a new challenger in the challenge. Although I haven't seen one Kino movie yet. I don't think I'm gonna find one either. They lied to me. I don't see any. This is when I go back on footage and be like, there's a Kino movie right there. Stupid. Yeah, there's not a single Kino movie here. Or even Cohen Media. Successful. Two of them I never even knew existed. So I would say it was a successful blind buy trip. I guess if I say two, that should probably give away we didn't get any Janus contemporaries, but we'll see what I got here in a little bit, I guess. I'm bad at this being actually like filmed. Let's go get lunch. I'm back. So I'm back from the Criterion sale. I did only pick up two things. I saw a lot of things I really kind of wanted, but we got two things, both from the Criterion collection and both films I knew nothing about. These are actually like complete blind buys to me. But we kind of ended up cheating a little bit, and I'll tell you why here in a second. So the first film we're going to talk about out of this Barnes & Noble bag is Faye Dahee. Faye Dahee is a documentary from 2021, directed by Jessica Bashir, and I also believe this is her directorial debut as a feature. But the film follows the growth of cat, I think I'm saying that right, the leaf drug that you can chew on. Is kind of like tobacco. You chew on these leaves and it has like some psychedelic purposes. But the film kind of explores the growth, the production of this drug, but also the effect it has on families, its users, and kind of the region in general. The film has a very surrealist take to it that almost has a dreamlike quality that kind of makes you feel like you're tripping a little bit as you're watching it. The visuals in this film are absolutely stunning. It's in black and white, but it has like a natural motion in its cinematography and its editing to kind of feel like on-screen poetry. The documentary feels so purposely structured and so purposely edited and shot in a way that at times it can feel more like a just regular written narrative than a documentary as a whole. Now, while I like the surrealist approach and some of the like loose narrative structures in terms of like how the film kind of floats through scenes and kind of puts you in a meditative state to kind of mimic the people that are using this drug, it does kind of hold back the narrative a little bit, as at certain times I felt like we spent maybe a little bit too long in these certain sections, to where I feel like at some points that narrative cohesion kind of starts to separate, but it's never enough to really take you out of the experience either. As we kind of bounce around from location to location or person to person, you really do kind of get a full sense of the life cycle of this drug and the people that are in this area. You kind of get a real sense of what prolonged use of this drug and production of this drug has kind of impacted the area as well. And it's just a really interesting documentary told with a lot of stylistic flair that I found to be really, really enjoyable, and I definitely recommend Faye Dahee, and I'm giving this one a 7 out of 10. Now, I say we cheated a little bit, and that mainly has to do with the next pick, but this film does come with three short films by Jessica Bashir as well. It comes with He Who Dances on Wood from 2016, Heroin from 2017, and Hyderat from 2017 as well. I hope I'm saying Hyderat right. For me, I really like Jessica Bashir's style. She does have kind of this like moving poetry kind of vibe to her films. He Who Dances on Wood follows a man who literally dances on wood. The film is told with his narration through some really beautifully shot slow motion scenes, and I really enjoyed that one. Heroin is about a painter who is like obsessed with painting the same person over and over and over again. It is like his
heroine in a way. And it's okay. There's some really good directorial decisions in this I really like. Most of the film is in black and white, but we get cut to color when he starts basically to work on a new project. And I really like that aspect a lot. It was just a great decision in stylistic choices that really like helped impact the film. But for like a 17-minute short film, I actually found this one to be the most boring of the entire set. And I just wasn't really connecting with that one. The last short film on here, Hi-Rat, is, I think, in my opinion, as a 6-minute short film, is worth this entire box set. It is fantastic. It is an outstanding short film documentary about a man who goes out and feeds hyenas in the wild. Basically, the village was having a problem with hyenas coming in and like killing livestock and stuff for food. So to kind of settle their beef with hyenas, somebody would go out to the hyenas and feed them. The entire thing is shot up close with these hyenas with very contrasting imagery. You just see this void of black, but then there's just these random hyenas that kind of pop in and out. And it's cold through like this, like it really does just feel like a 6-minute poem. It's like a poem about life and synchronicity with humanity and nature. And it's awesome. That alone, like I said, that short film alone to me is worth the box set or this release, I guess. But I also definitely recommend Faye Dehi. And I do recommend the other short films as well. If I were to rate the short films, He Who Dances on Wood would get a solid 7 out of 10. Heroin would get a 6. And Hi-Rat would get an 8 out of 10. Really enjoy this box set. I really honestly can't wait to see what Jessica Bashir does next. She's going to be a director that I'll pretty much keep my eye out for from here on out. And yeah, great, great blind buy. So when I picked up Faye Dehi, I didn't know those short films was on there, but I knew we were kind of cheating the challenge a little bit with A Story of Floating Weeds and Floating Weeds. This is a box set that comes with both A Story of Floating Weeds and the movie Floating Weeds. These are two films by Yasujirō Ozu. I hope I'm saying that right. I just looked it up. All right. I just looked it up. I hope I'm saying it right. But these were two films I have never heard of, but I just saw that box art and was just like, I need to check this out. This is such cool box art. And I read the back of the box about what the story is about, and it sounded really interesting. The original film, A Story of Floating Weeds, is from 1934. It is an 86-minute black and white silent film, and I loved it. I loved this silent film. I thought the story was fantastic. At 86 minutes, it is perfectly paced. The way the story unfolds, it says so much with saying so little, because it's one of those silent films that has the dialogue cards. And like I said, it just says so much with so little. Both of these films are about the exact same story. So the idea of the story is a acting troupe comes into town to perform shows. And while there, the owner of the troupe or the leader or master of the troupe goes and finds his ex-lover, who they have a son together. The son, however, thinks that this dude is his uncle and that his real father had died. Well, when his new lover, who's a part of the acting troupe, finds out about his past, she ends up devising a plan to let one of the actors fall in love with his son, and everything kind of unravels from there. Takashi Sakamoto just does an amazing job in the lead here. Like, his performance is fantastic. It absolutely grounds the film and allows the emotional core of the film to just resonate with the audience. He carries so much baggage, so much weight, and almost just emotional guilt throughout the entire film, and it's felt every moment he's on screen, you know, kind of amplifying that saying so much with so little. But again, you know, we have an 86 minutes of a runtime that's all silent film, but the film does a really amazing job to develop all the main characters here, and including most of the acting troupe as well, to give a true sense of chemistry between all the characters, a true sense of history within the group, and every character feels like a well-developed, realistic character that just allows you to like latch on to everything you're seeing on screen. Speaking on screen, this film is beautifully shot. I think the cinematography in this film is absolutely incredibly well done. It is a very visually striking black and white movie. Just the framing alone, though, I just love the way this film looks just through its framing. My one big downside with this film, apparently Criterion commissioned a new score for this film, and I just found the score to be really hokey. A lot of the time it felt really unfitting with some of the emotional tone I think the film was trying to convey, and I just, yeah, wasn't a big fan of the score. I get what they're going for. They're trying to say, like, you know, this is Ozu's like style of music that he liked and stuff, and it definitely feels like it'd be more fitting with the remake than it does the original. But yeah, I just constantly kept feeling like the score was kind of unfitting with the film itself. But overall, yeah, I love A Story of Floating Weeds. I give it an 8 out of 10. It could go up on a second viewing, and if you want a really awesome like recommendation for a silent film, definitely check it out. Now we cut to 1959. So from 34 to 59, about 25 years later, Ozu decides to remake his film, and just calling it Floating Weeds this time. He shoots this film in color and also with sound, and I don't know if it's just because I watched these two films films back to back, but I didn't like this one as much as the silent film. I preferred the silent film over this one. Both stories are pretty much exactly the same. There are some minor changes, like one character names are different, but there's some minor changes in like how the story unfolds or some of the character interactions from the first film into the second film, and they're not enough differences to really like point out or make that much of a difference. They're basically the same experience. They're basically the same film. However, Floating Weeds is about a half an hour longer, and I personally felt it. Again, like I said, I don't know if it's just where I watch these both back to back. I definitely would watch both of these again. But one thing that was kind of holding me back with the Floating Weeds remake was, one, I didn't like the performances nearly as much in this one as I did in the original. I just thought that some of the performances wasn't nearly as good. Genjiro Nakamori, who plays the lead in this one, like I said, they had different character names. That's why I'm not saying a name. His performance just didn't feel as strong as Sakamoto's. And I kind of feel that way with like most of the cast. I also really feel like this film kind of ignored more of the troop, kind of just leaning in more of the leader and his ex fleeing and his son. And I kind of missed that from the original. Like, I kind of liked how the original kind of developed all the individual players a lot more than what this film felt like. And I really don't understand where the extra half an hour is needed here. Like, I really do feel like the original film's pacing was tight, like right on the money tight, like super duper tight. And I don't feel that way here. I feel like there are some pacing issues. There are some lulls where I was kind of losing interest. Again, it could just be because I watched these two films back to back. It does seem like more people like this remake more than the original, considering it has higher ratings, but it also has like double the ratings too. So, you know, take that into account. But I personally just really enjoyed both of these. I definitely think both films are worth a recommendation. They both serve different purposes, I guess, because one is a silent film, one's not a silent film. And I also feel like silent films, some people are just not going to be into wanting to watch a silent film, which I guess I get. Yeah, I really enjoyed both of these. And I got to be honest with you, doing this little challenge, there was a lot of things that as I was leaving, I was like FOMOing about, being like, I wish I would have grabbed this. But I will say the two things I grabbed, I'm really pleased with. I think they're both quality releases that I would definitely recommend picking up if you're going out Criterion shopping and you want some solid recommendations. Definitely recommend both of these, and thanks for watching. But if you want to support what I do, you can consider subscribing. I would love to hear what you picked up recently from Criterion. If you want to leave it down below, maybe some recommendations. And if you want to support what I do, you can consider subscribing, becoming a member or Patreon. Bye everybody, happy hunting.